Dear student, Assalamu alaikum. My this lecture is again in continuation of the chapter that is concerned with osmolarity and the countercurrent mechanism. We have seen in detail all the countercurrent mechanism. Now we are going to see the effect of mainly the aldosterone and the angiotensin. These are the two hormones which are concerned with the osmolarity. But before starting or before going to, into the details of all these things, keep in mind that the osmolarity is more affected by the ADH and the thrust mechanism as compared to the aldosterone and the angiotensin II. We usually study thrust mechanism and the ADH simultaneously at the same time, or you can say on the other hand, we study aldosterone and angiotensin II simultaneously. Let's start with the aldosterone. Aldosterone is your mineralocorticoid. Aldosterone, here is written the aldosterone, mineralocorticoid. It is coming from the zona granulosa. Here is your adrenal gland. This adrenal gland is present at the top of your kidney here, the adrenal gland. It has got different layers of the cortex. This is the cortex, and the cortex has got a capsule, and below the capsule, the outermost layer, which is known as the zona granulosa. Then we have got zona fasciculata, and last one we have got the zona reticularis, the innermost layer. We are at this time we are concerned with this layer, zona granulosa. This is the zona granulosa cell. These are the cells which are produced your mineralocorticoids, that is, these are the corticoids which are concerned mainly the minerals, and that these minerals are sodium and the potassium. They are mainly concerned with the sodium and the potassium. Although if we move below the zona fasciculata over here, it is concerned with the production of the glucocorticoids. They are more concerned with the glucose. And last one is the androgen. The innermost zona reticular is concerned with the production of the androgen. These are the name. We have got a separate lecture for this one. And the, then we have got the medulla, which is concerned with the production of the sympathetic, concerned with the production of the epinephrine medulla. We are at this moment, we are going into the detail of this mineralocorticoid. But you keep in mind that this mineralocorticoid and glucocorticoid, they have got some overlapping properties. The major of this one is the mineralocorticoid is the control the sodium and the potassium inside your body. Glucocorticoid, they are concerned with the glucose metabolism, but glucocorticoid, they also can retain some sodium potassium, some sodium in your body. They can enhance the, your sodium level, the glucocorticoids. We are moving towards our main topic, that is the mineralocorticoid, and main mineralocorticoid is the aldosterone, which is coming from the zona granulosa cells of the cortex of the adrenal gland. Now all these hormones, which are mainly the aldosterone, the cortisol and the androstenedione, all these are coming from the parent compound, the cholesterol. I'm not going into the details of all these things. This is the biochemistry. We will see all these things in the rest of the chapter of the endocrinology. But here, just to make you understand that the cholesterol is the precursor of the aldosterone. It is also the precursor of the cortisol and the androstenedione, mainly your testosterone, estrogen. These are produced from the cholesterol. Now, aldosterone, the main function is the reabsorption or the retention of sodium in your body and excretion of the potassium from your body. Excretion of the potassium and reabsorption of the sodium and the water. Now, keep in mind that ADH, which is concerned with the reabsorption of the pure water, that is not associated with the reabsorption of sodium, but aldosterone absorbs, or you can say the reabsorption under the effect of aldosterone is of both the thing, that is sodium and the water. Both these are reabsorbed by the aldosterone. At the same time, it is caused the excretion, first the secretion of the potassium and then excretion of the potassium from the body. So whenever you give aldosterone, it will cause the excretion, that is, it make the plasma with the low potassium. the potassium become low if you give aldosterone. If you give aldosterone, it will increase your sodium and water. Ultimately, there will be increase in the blood volume. The blood volume is going to be increased. Now, this mineralocorticoids, aldosterone, the main site of action is on the P cells of the distal convoluted tubule and collecting ducts. Then, how the mechanism of action, we will see later on, that how it's going to cause the effect. Basically, it is going to cause the increase, or you can say, here the words are written, upregulation and the activation of the sodium-potassium pump. This sodium-potassium pump will cause the reabsorption of the sodium and excretion of the potassium from the body. Now, in the next slide, we will see what are the different stimuli for the production of this aldosterone, and here is the in order of their importance, that how much important. The main, one of the most important stimulus for the production of the aldosterone is increase in the potassium level, increase in the potassium or the extracellular fluid. So this is the main stimulus for the production of the aldosterone. Definitely when you have more potassium, you need to excrete it. And this stimulates the production of aldosterone, and this aldosterone will cause the excretion of this potassium. Then angiotensin 2. Angiotensin 2 is going to increase the aldosterone secretion. Actually, this aldosterone is going to stimulate your sodium potassium pump. Angiotensin 2 also stimulates your sodium potassium pump. At the same time, it causes the production of aldosterone more and more. So this angiotensin 2 has got both, so you can say, dual effect on your sodium potassium pump. One is, it's going to, this angiotensin 2 is directly going to stimulate your sodium potassium pump. Secondly, it causes the production of aldosterone, which again stimulates the sodium potassium pump. So this two things, the first and second point, they are the most important regulator of the your aldosterone production. Then increase in sodium ion. If it is increased sodium ion, it will cause a decrease in aldosterone secretion. Decrease. But it's very slight. Its effect is very slight. Then ACTH. ACTH from the anterior pituitary is necessary for the aldosterone secretion. But it has very little effect on the rate of secretion. So the ACTH, increasing sodium, all of both of these, they have got the effect, but they have got the minor effect. Actually, ACTH has got the permissive effect. Permissive effect. If there is no ACTH, there will be no aldosterone. So ACTH starts or begins the production of this one, but day-to-day regulation or minute-to-minute regulation is done by the potassium level and your angiotensin 2 level, which is coming from the kidney. Now, this, how this aldosterone is going to affect. Basically, this I am going to show you a diagram. Here is a diagram. This diagram is made for some other thing, but on here concentrate on this one. Here you have got the, this is your collecting ducts, this is the interstitium, here you have got the lumen. Lumen where the urine is coming out, the lumen is the, your interstitium. This is the principal cells. In the principal cells, although the ADH is also going to affect on this principal cell, but here you have got on the basolateral surface, you have got the sodium potassium pump. Here we have got the receptors for the aldosterone, and we have got this epithelial E channel, E sodium, these are known as the E sodium channel, that is the epithelial sodium channels. Here is the epithelial sodium channels. Now aldosterone, once combined over the receptors, is going to stimulate this sodium potassium pump, and it will cause the movement of three sodium from the cell, principal cell, into the interstitium, that is the reabsorption, and it will pick up two potassium from the interstitium into the principal cell, and from here this potassium is going to leak, or through the potassium leak channels, into the lumen, where it will be drained into the urine. It will be drained into the urine. Now These e-channels are also formed under the effect of your aldosterone. So the aldosterone stimulates this pump, and aldosterone makes the more and more formation of the e-sodium channels. From this e-sodium channel, the sodium moves from lumen into the principal cells, and through the pump, this sodium will move into the interstitium. So this is the reabsorption, or you can say the mechanism of the reabsorption of sodium from lumen into the P cells through the E channels, and these E channels are also formed under the effect of your aldosterone. Then once they are inside the principal cells, it will cause the excessive functioning of this ATPase pump. It will, from here, this three sodium, they will move into the interstitium, that it will be the reabsorbed. Now, here, very important diuretic we give. That is the spironolactone. Spironolactone is a diuretic we usually give in the chronic liver disease. This spironolactone is the antagonist. It's going to block this aldosterone receptor. Once it is blocked, this aldosterone cannot bind with this one, and aldosterone cannot perform its function without binding. So once aldosterone will not be there, the sodium reabsorption from the E epithelial cell will not be possible, and this functioning will not be, it will become lazy, it will not be speedy. That's why the sodium cannot be reabsorbed from this side, and this sodium will be drained out from the body through the urine along with the water. And we have got another diuretic which is known as amiodarone. It is also called a trimetrine. So this is going to block this E channels. If this E channels are blocked, sodium cannot enter from this side to this side. That's why all the sodium will be drained outside. This is the one mechanism of action of your aldosterone. Secondly, this aldosterone is going to affect the alpha intercalated cells. These are also present in your distal convoluted tubule and your cortical collecting duct. And you see that here you have got another receptor for the aldosterone. This aldosterone will cause the effectiveness of this, or you can say the ATPase pump present over here. This is actually known as the hydrogen ATPase pump. It will cause excessive functioning of this ATP, hydrogen ATPase pump. This will cause movement of the hydrogen into the lumen, and from here it will be drained out. Again, we have got another pump which is going to counter transport of potassium inside and hydrogen outside. So all these things, this one and this one, both they become hyperactive due to the presence of aldosterone, and hydrogen will leave the intercalated cell and enter into your lumen, and it will be drained or excreted in the urine. So this movement of the hydrogen, or you can say actually this is the acid. When you remove the acid in the urine, then it will cause alkalosis. So whenever this aldosterone, excessive aldosterone is given, it will cause alkalosis. So, and again, due to the movement of the potassium more and more from this side, it will cause decrease in potassium. And because potassium is lost into the urine, and due to the excessive reabsorption of the sodium, it will cause more and more sodium in your body. All these things will be discussed again when we will see the Cone syndrome. So this was all these things. Then this, all these things which I have told you, that is written over here, you can see all these things. That it, chloride is reabsorbed in conjunction with the sodium cations. It stimulates the secretion of potassium into the tubular lumen. It stimulates sodium and the water reabsorption from the gut also, that GIT, salivary and the sweat glands in exchange for the potassium. Then it stimulates the secretion of hydrogen ion in exchange for the potassium in the intercalated cells of the cortical collecting duct, regulating the plasma bicarb level and its acid-base balance. Again, aldosterone is responsible for the reabsorption of about 2% of the filtered sodium in the kidney. Now, one thing which is usually asked in the Viva and the University question, what is meant by the aldosterone escape? Actually, under the effect of aldosterone, when there is excessive reabsorption and the water in the body, that is more in sodium and water is retained in your body through the kidney, then your volume overload is there. You have got more and more blood volume, and this blood volume will increase your basically this blood volume. When the extracellular blood volume is going to increase by 10 to 15%, it will increase the blood pressure, and when the blood pressure will be more, it is going to affect your kidneys, and this kidney begin to excrete excessive sodium retained by the aldosterone and the water through pressure natriuresis and diuresis. We have seen this pressure natriuresis and diuresis in our classroom lectures. So, although the aldosterone has got effect in the reabsorption of the water and the sodium, but excessive retention will increase your blood volume. Blood volume will increase your blood pressure, and this blood pressure when will it will affect your kidney. The kidney will excrete excess of sodium and water through a process which is known as the pressure natriuresis and diuresis, and your sodium and water level becomes normal. So this is known as aldosterone escape. That means aldosterone is there, but its function or its effectiveness is less, we are expecting from this hormone. Although it is present, but due to the effect of the kidney, the process which you know, the pressure natriuresis and diuresis, these effects become low in your body. This is known as the aldosterone escape. And now we are going to discuss a very important pathology which is known as the hyperaldosteronism. This is the hyperaldosteronism. Before going to hyperaldosteronism, I'm going to repeat one thing, that here is your afferent arteriole, which is blood flow is coming from this side. This is your glomerulus, this is your efferent arteriole, and here we have got the Bowman capsule, the proximal tubule, loop of Henle. Ultimately, we do to the distal convoluted tubule, and this is your P cell, integrated cell. We have seen all these things. So, whenever there is less blood flow, the decrease in blood flow there, now the kidneys they are going to produce angiotensin II. Although the angiotensinogen, which is coming from the liver, and renin is coming from your glomerulus, and renin is going to convert angiotensinogen into angiotensin I. This angiotensin I will cross the lungs, and in the lungs it is going to be converted into the angiotensin II. This angiotensin II is going to stimulate your zona granulosa cells. These cells, they produce more and more aldosterone, and this aldosterone is going to show all these functions which I have discussed very soon, which we have discussed previously. Now, this hyperaldosteronism is of two types. One is known as the primary hyperaldosteronism, which is known as the Cone syndrome, and other is known as the secondary hyperaldosteronism. Secondary means your adrenal gland is normal and it is producing more aldosterone under the effect or under the effect of some other diseases. For example, if there is a renal artery stenosis, if this renal artery stenosis is there, definitely blood will move less over here, and again the process, the renin, angiotensinogen, angiotensin I, II, and same thing is going to repeat. Now, and congestive cardiac failure, that is your heart is not pumping enough blood to the kidney. The cardiac failure is there. Your heart is not pumping enough blood. So when less blood is flowing to this area, again the same process will start. Then the liver diseases. Actually, in the liver diseases and the nephrotic syndrome, all your albumin, which is responsible for the oncotic pressure of your body, is coming from the liver. So if the liver diseases are there, for example, liver cirrhosis or the chronic liver disease, so less production of albumin and your oncotic pressure will be less. At the same time, nephrotic syndrome, where your loss of albumin is there. So in both these conditions, here the production is less, here the loss is more. So in both these conditions, you have got the hypoalbuminemia. And when albumin is less, oncotic pressure is less. So Now your blood cannot stay in the vessels and it will move out into the interstitial tissue spaces. The plasma will move out, leading to the edema. When edema is going to occur, so the effective circulatory volume is less. Now, suppose this is your follow my cursor. Suppose this is your blood vessel. Suppose this is a blood vessel. Here the albumin is not there, it's less. So the oncot, this is your albumin is going to cause the retention of water within the vessel. Now, due to the decreased amount of the albumin inside the lumen, the water will move out into the interstitial tissue spaces. Now, although this water in the interstitial tissue spaces, it is present in your body. It is your total body blood volume is there. But the blood which is circulating in your blood vessels is now less. Now the blood which is moving, circulating in your blood vessels is known the effective circulatory volume. So in both these conditions, when the edema is going to occur, in effective circulatory volume is less. So when the effective circulatory volume is less, blood flow to the kidney will decrease. Again, same things they are going to be repeated now. So if you see that the aldosterone in this secondary hyperaldosteronism, aldosterone definitely it will be more, and all these aldosterone mechanisms are working through renin. So renin will be the more, and when the aldosterone is there, retention of sodium will be the more, potassium will be lost, so the potassium will less, and due to the movement of hydrogen out of the body leading to the alkalosis. So these are the things which are present in the secondary hyperaldosteronism. But on the other hand, if unfortunately there is a tumor of the zona granulosa cell, these are usually the adenomas. So this adenoma is going to cause the production of more and more aldosterone, and this is known as the Cone syndrome. And again, aldosterone is more. So all these things will be the same, but except one thing, that is the renin. This blue spot, you can see the blue spot. Here, aldosterone production is not under the effect of decreased blood flow, but this is the intrinsic property. This is the intrinsic property of the zona granulosa cells, because here you have got, unfortunately, you have got a tumor. So it is not stimulated by all these processes, the renin, angiotensinogen 1, 2. This stimulation is off, it's crossed, it is off. Now this zona granulosa cells, they have got tumor over here, usually the adenomas, they will cause the production of all the aldosterone, and remaining process will be the same. So here one thing will be different, that aldosterone is more, but renin will not be more, it will be less. So if renin is less, that means there is a primary tumor or the Cone syndrome. Other things, due to the effect of aldosterone, there is more sodium, more potassium, alkalosis, all these things will remain the same. So this was all about the aldosterone and the Cone syndrome. Thank you very much.